Hello and welcome to yet another Mantissa Data Science webinar. My name is Imad Mohammed Khan and I organize Mantissa Data Science meetups and webinars. I will give you a little bit of an introduction on what Mantissa has been doing so far, and then I will introduce the speaker. And after that, we will have a fireside chat with the speaker. And then hopefully towards the end, we will have some time for questions and answers. Today, we have with us Shadab Khan. Thank you so much, Shadab, for taking the time to do this session with us. I'll just give a brief introduction of what Shadab has done, and maybe then I will allow him to say a few words. So Shadab leads a team of applied scientists and engineers at G42 to solve problems in healthcare AI. His team develops solutions for clinical care, healthcare operations, and healthcare finance by analyzing structured and unstructured data sets ranging from electronic health records, genomics, medical imaging, and claims, among others. Before joining G42 Healthcare, Shadab was a researcher at the Inception Institute of AI in UAE, where he focused on machine learning from limited data. Shadab obtained his PhD from Dartmouth College in Biomedical Engineering and did a research fellowship at Harvard Medical School and Boston Children's Hospital in Radiology. I think Shadab is a great candidate for a fireside chat because he has such varied experiences. And I'm really excited for the session. Yeah, Shadab, if you would like to introduce yourself in a few words.
Sure. Thank you so much, Imad. Thank you so much for inviting me here. And really happy to hear about how organically Mantissa Data Science has grown as a community. Really exciting to see that, you know, regardless of the locations and the community, resources such as Jeremy Howard's famous fast.ai courses are benefiting so much. I personally used it myself and found it very, very useful to get started with in this area. So as you already mentioned, I lead a team of applied scientists here at G42 Healthcare in Abu Dhabi. G42 is a company which is fairly new to the space. We're in existence for the past 3 years, based here in Abu Dhabi, and you know, looking at several verticals of interests, and of course healthcare among them. Where I currently work.
Cool. Okay. If do you have more to add?
No, I'm good for now.
Okay. So if that is the case, then I'll also brief the audience on question and answers. There is a place for Q&A on the right side of your screen, perhaps, where you can go and drop your questions. We can either take them during the session if we have time. While we are having this fireside chat, or towards the end of the session, we will of course pick some of them up and talk with Shadab on that. So yeah, if you have any questions, please feel free to drop them in the Q&A section or even in the chat section. I will be taking a look at them during the session as well. Okay, so with that said, let's start with the first part of our chat, which is the AI in healthcare, and which is what I was advertising everywhere, because this is an interesting a subdomain of, say, AI, or rather the area in which AI is being applied. And your background makes it even more interesting. You have an engineering background, but your PhD and the subsequent work is in the healthcare domain. So how did this happen, and what inspired you to work in healthcare? I think you're muted.
Has to be the most committed mistake. And I started off, I got interested in healthcare as a domain. I took up a research assistant position at Institute for Systems and Robotics in Lisbon, Portugal, where I spent a better part of 6 months as part of my bachelor's thesis work to work on a problem called automatic karyotyping, where the idea is you have these chromosomes which are, you know, twisted and disoriented and sometimes overlapping on top of each other. And you have to essentially disentangle them and arrange them in a neat order, so the pathologists can analyze them for any signatures of disease or abnormality, so to speak. And that was, broadly speaking, a medical image analysis problem. And that was what really sparked my interest in not just image analysis, but specifically medical image analysis, because working in healthcare, it's hard not to feel the importance of the problems you're working on. You know, as cliched as it might sound, it really is a very satisfying domain to be working on. And particularly for those reasons, I started looking at PhD positions in medical image analysis or and related areas. Luckily, I got an admit from Dartmouth to work with Ryan Halter on developing a medical imaging device, which was again focused on analyzing signatures of bioimpedance as a biomarker to identify whether there is a signature of cancer in the imaging domain or not. And that was really interesting because you often get to work with images that are coming from a medical imaging scanner. But this was really a rather, you know, at least to me, it sounded like a very unique opportunity to work on building the medical imaging device itself. And that was very exciting. So I actually got involved as an electrical engineer. In fact, my PhD was focused on medical imaging device development more than the analysis of images themselves. And you know, so from there on, I was towards the end of my PhD, I explored the interest area that got me to Dartmouth in the first place, the image analysis side. And I thought I wanted to explore that a bit more, so I, you know, started looking for postdoc positions and ended up in Ali Golipur's lab at Boston Children's and Harvard, where I focused on computational analysis of diffusion-weighted imaging acquired from the fetuses who were live fetuses, you know, from the pregnant woman. So although I've been an engineer first and, you know, use these methods from electrical engineering and computer science in my line of work so far, the application domain has so far been primarily healthcare. And yeah, so that's how, being an engineer, I got into the area and really, really enjoy working in healthcare.
Cool. Sounds really cool. I think one related question that I would have to that is, like, how did you, I mean, of course, you said you've come from that engineering background and your primary skill set is more towards engineering. But if you're working on an analysis project in a particular domain, then oftentimes if you lack the understanding of the domain, you're likely to make inferences that are not perhaps, that perhaps a domain expert would not make. Right. So how did you overcome those, say, I mean, so to speak, shortcomings, or did you really try to beef up on the domain side as well?
That's a very good question. So, you know, it's and I think what I did sort of changed as I grew in my career. Early on, I really used to try to learn even the domain ideas myself. But very soon you hit a wall and you realize, you know, medicine is an expertise by itself and you can't just learn it on Coursera or wherever it is, right? So
if you ask a computer scientist, he will say it's just a dictionary.
Right. So not all the answers are found on WebMD, Mark. So, you know, one of the advantages of being at Dartmouth was that it's a really small community, and we work very closely with our medical school collaborators. And at some point you realize, you know, it's just easier to ask them the questions than try to figure everything out on your own. And so what I realized was it was still very useful and in fact necessary to pick up a working vocabulary so you're able to communicate effectively with your collaborators, but you definitely don't need to learn everything by yourself. You can't. Can't really, right? So I think having the right vocabulary, you know, enables you to be an effective communicator within the team, and then that allows you to understand the problem space that you're addressing a bit better than you would if you did not have that working vocabulary. So that's what I started focusing on when I read research papers or when I watched lectures. You know, these, you see a recurring theme of keywords that come up often. So, you know, just looking those words up and trying to memorize what their meanings are. And so that was helpful. And this is what I continued on later during my career. So when I moved to Boston and even during my time at Inception and G42, for any new domain area that I try to address, I do try to, learn the basics, but then stop there and then hopefully find collaborators who are masters of their game and, work with them. To give you one example, among the resources that I found really useful are the introductory biology course from MIT on Coursera. And oftentimes there are review papers that would be helpful for you when you come into a clinical problem as an engineer. So these are some of the resources that I've used.
Great. Okay, speaking of memorizing, so take us through a memorable project that has been etched in your memory for a long period of time. What is something that makes that project memorable, and what were the problems you faced and how?
So I think I really thoroughly enjoyed my project work during my postdoc. It was a very hard problem. The idea is that you have these, in neuroscience, a lot of the neuroscientists often rely on what is called an atlas of a brain, which is essentially like a map of the brain, right? So it turns out that atlases of fetuses are not very widely available for a lot of reasons. The image atlases are often computed from these images of the subjects that are acquired. Mm-hmm. So on one hand, you have these human connectome project where you have 7 Tesla scans of human mm-hmm. brain, which describe the anatomy in exquisite detail, available to make your life easy for computing these atlases, right? And with these higher resolution, essentially maps, you can start to study the anatomy, right? And that tells you a lot about what the reference is. Essentially, it's in some ways, trying to take image of thousands of people and then trying to figure out what does the average face look like. So you can focus on the differences rather than the similarities. And oftentimes, that's a simplified example, but it turns out in study of human brains, it's often useful to know what the differences are, to assess if that change in structure has any impact on the function, right? And that then dictates, various abilities that you might possess as a human and so on. So it turns out that atlases of fetal brains are really hard to acquire because fetuses, they move a lot, and the MRI scanners make a loud noise. So when a pregnant woman, if she's lying on the bed, because of the noise and just the agitation, the space is different, and so fetuses move a lot, right? And these MRI images take in the order of a few minutes to tens of minutes to be acquired, particularly these diffusion weighted scans that we were interested in. And so that was the problem that I focused on. It was really challenging again because the motion makes the problem very hard. There are a lot of artifacts, and the way these 3D MRI images are acquired, they're acquired slice by slice, right? So it's sort of like you're trying to slice a watermelon, right? Mm-hmm. At equal spacing from above. And imagine that instead of the watermelon being steady, let's say you're holding the watermelon and I'm slicing it, but instead of holding it steady, you're just moving it all the time, right? And so if I were to try to put together the watermelon by, stacking the slices one over the other, I'll probably not end up with the same shape as I had because of the motion, right? So mm-hmm. That's what made it hard. And working with the team there, we came up with algorithms and methods to compensate for that motion and try to reconstruct the anatomical details. And so that was so that ended up being the world's first reference for the diffusion weighted atlas of the fetal brain. And diffusion imaging is really interesting because it allows you to study the white matter tracts of the brain. You know, these tracts are like wires or threads that run through the brain and connect different areas. And any deformities or you know, any changes from the reference tracts can then be evaluated for any impact on the function, right? And so to be able to even investigate that hypothesis, whether or not someone's abnormal tracts have any impact on their function, you need that reference first. And so, you know, developing these motion compensated imaging methods, we ended up being the world's first team to produce an atlas of fetal brain in second and third trimester of pregnancy. And as part of the solution, we actually employed both, you know, the classical model-based approaches for registration, along with some, you know, newer deep learning-based approaches for segmentation of the fetal brain to stabilize that registration problem a little bit. And so it ended up being a very satisfying project, you know, with lots of different complexities, and you really had to throw, you know, a lot of the computational power at it from both classical and the newer algorithms to be able to come up with a solution that was satisfying.
Cool. Sounds really, really like a lot of work. And finally, a good solution that you could be satisfied with.
Yes, indeed. The atlas is publicly available. You know, if anyone's interested.
I think you can share the link with me, and I can maybe add it here. If you have it now, you can put it in the chat, or maybe later. Sure. I can add it on the YouTube video as well. So building the atlas itself was a challenge, you said, right? Because of the continuous motion of the fetus. And then you're not able to, say, reconstruct back to what it originally is supposed to be because you're not able to capture the overall image in its most accurate form, so to speak.
Right.
And that is essentially a problem of building the right data set. If you look at it, right, you don't have that data set. And this is a problem I've seen in the industry, especially with healthcare, because And it happens because, especially with the diseases and stuff, right? You don't have data sets easily available. And even if they are, it's likely to be a more imbalanced version of the population because it's only a subset of population is infected with a certain disease. So my next question is on that line. So building ML solutions in healthcare is often challenging because availability of, say, labeled data is limited. So what have you had these problems, and if you had had them, what are some of the ways in which you've been able to tackle them?
Right. I think anyone who has worked in healthcare ML has faced these challenges. You're very right, Imad. So in fact, this particular problem is very close to my heart. You know, it's something that I've been focusing on for the past 3 years during my time at Inception, and continue to focus on it at G42, because, excuse me, the problem of low data in low label data in healthcare is not going to go away anytime soon. Right. So I've looked at specifically three different ways of addressing this. First, I've looked at, you know, the problem of actually generating more labeled data more easily. So one of the projects that I did with an intern at Inception was to look at ways to assist an annotator, essentially a radiologist, in more quickly being able to annotate, you know, the segmentation, more quickly be able to annotate the objects in an image, whether it's for segmentation or classification problem. We developed some methods that instead of a radiologist having to, you know, annotate at a pixel level where an object lies, they could just you know, put in four clicks at what we call the extreme points, And from these four clicks, we're then able to produce a full segmentation of the object that was intended. And we've tried the method on different CT and MRI images for different organs, and it works fairly well. So that was one of the projects we did. Our contribution in that particular line of work was to come up with these principles that allow us to encode what we call a confidence map. So we take the four extreme points and then we try to assess, okay, if a user has given me four extreme points for an object, then it is quite likely then that the line connecting the extreme points lies on the object more so than the points that are away from these lines connecting the extreme points. And then we came up with some mathematical models to encode the distances from these lines as a confidence map. And then we used this confidence map as a prior to produce the final full segmentation. So that was a way in which we tried to accelerate the annotation process itself, because if you only have a limited time to annotate, instead of producing limited annotations on a few images, you produce these AI assisted annotations on lots of different images. Mm-hmm. So that was one way. In another project, we actually looked at something called active learning, which is actually a very interesting and very very well studied area within the machine learning. In active learning, the idea is you have a pool of labeled samples and a pool of unlabeled samples, and you try to learn a model from the labeled samples, and then you use this model somehow to try to understand which of the samples from the unlabeled set need to be annotated to come up with a model that's better than the model you would learn if you were to randomly draw some samples from the unlabeled set. I'll use an analogy to describe this. I'm not sure if it's going to be useful, but let's say that you were a trainee chef, right? And the master chef charges you a fee for each dish that they teach you, right? And you were on a budget trying to minimize what you spend, mm-hmm. While trying to maximize how many new dishes you're able to make, right? Mm-hmm. So let's say that you're trying to learn Thai cuisine, and one of the dishes you learn from the master is red curry with tofu, mm-hmm. right? Let's say another dish that you try to learn from the master is green curry with chicken, right? And let's say for each of these dishes, you've already paid $100 per dish, okay? Now, would it be useful for you to learn green curry with tofu? So green curry with tofu is one thing that you learned. Red curry with chicken is another thing you learned. So would it be useful for you to learn red curry with tofu? I hope I'm keeping track here. But the idea is this, right? So if you know how to prepare the proteins in these two different dishes, one with green curry flavor and one with red curry flavor, you can probably extrapolate that knowledge, right? And prepare both green curry with tofu and chicken and red curry with tofu, yeah, and chicken. So these redundancies in your data, right? How much your data elements are useful for learning a better model. Mm-hmm. That's what we try to assess with active learning. And so, having a model that you learn from the limited initial set, mm-hmm. you try to come up with heuristics to draw, let's call them a more discriminative set of samples from the unlabeled set, mm-hmm. To then retrain your initial model. And the idea is, if I'm going to pay a radiologist, let's say, $200 per CT scan for annotating lung cancer nodules in that CT scan, then I better be sending them CT images that are more conducive for the learning algorithm that I'm trying to use to train the model, right? And so, So that's what we try to assess using active learning. And we explored multiple different heuristics to draw samples from the unlabeled set. You can think of one simple heuristic as an uncertainty-based model. So the idea is, if your classifier produces a score between 0 and 1, you try to draw the samples for which your model is most confused, right? Yeah. So if you have your model producing a result of 0.5, or close to the threshold that you optimize using an ROC or something else, you might want to send that for annotation. But on the other hand, you could be looking at the latent space structure of your mm-hmm. of your data to try to identify which samples are furthest away from the labeled set that in your latent space, and use distance-based heuristics mm-hmm. to draw a set. And so we explored a few different approaches in that line of work, and we have a paper in preparation to be submitted to a journal, and the draft is already out on archive. So that was active learning to see, okay, if we have to get annotated, which images make more sense. Mm-hmm. And finally, the other approaches that we're looking at is semi-supervised and self-supervised learning models. Mm-hmm. So, in computer vision world, there has been this rather impressive progress made in the past 2-3 years, where mm-hmm. we're now seeing ImageNet top 1 accuracy in the order of 90%. Compared to the 80% or so which was I think the top one accuracy maybe a few years ago. And so all of this progress has been unlocked with these algorithms called semi-supervised or self-supervised mm-hmm. learning methods. I'll briefly describe them. So in semi-supervised learning algorithms, the idea is that you have a labeled set, you train a model on it, and then you produce what we call pseudo labels on the unlabeled set. And then you retrain your initial model, combining the labeled set and the pseudo labels that your model produces. And you repeat this a few times, so this is, and there is this framework which is called the teacher-student training approach, where, the initial model that produces the pseudo label is considered a teacher, and the model that learns from both the labeled set as well as the pseudo labels is called the student. Mm-hmm. So by doing this knowledge distillation between teacher and student back and forth, you try to come up with a model that is actually better than a model that you would have learned if you were only learning from the labeled set, right? Mm-hmm. In this learning paradigm, you have not increased your annotation budget by any means, right? You still do not have any labels on the unlabeled set of images or samples, but you still end up with a model that performs much better than the model you would have if you were only learning from the labeled set, right? And similar approaches have been tried in a learning paradigm called self-supervised approaches, where you learn a proxy task. So for example, on all of your available images with and without labels, you could rotate them by a certain mm-hmm. amount, right? Let's say 90 mm-hmm. degree, and then try to predict that rotation mm-hmm. As a proxy task. Mm-hmm. And then you repeat this learning process, right? Many times over with many different samples. And so you end up with what we call a foundation model, right? And then mm-hmm. you fine-tune this foundation model on your actual task, for example, classification on, a limited label data. And so it turns out that, this learning paradigm can also work fairly well, particularly if you have, an unlabeled set that is very large as compared to your initial labeled set. Mm-hmm. In some studies from Google and Facebook, we've seen that they've used an unlabeled set in the order of 300 million or even billion of images mm-hmm. as compared to the ImageNet, which is around 1 million images, right? So mm-hmm. So we're looking at the semi-supervised and self-supervised learning approaches particularly in our studies with semi-supervised learning approaches on chest X-ray analysis, we've seen some extremely promising results, and we're in the process of preparing a manuscript. So I'll hope to share a draft with you as soon as it's out on archive. But the results are really promising, to the point where we're not really seeing any difference between training with 100% labeled data versus training with 10% labeled data in these with what we call these strongly regularized semi-supervised learning regimes. So so these are the three ways in which me and my team have looked at addressing limited data problem. First one was, how do we accelerate the annotation process? Second one was, if we were to seek annotations, which images? And finally, if we just could not seek additional annotations, how do we make use of unlabeled data sets to improve the performance of our models?
Mm-hmm. Cool.
But this is, far from solved problem, and we have, lots to accomplish still.
All right. Thank you so much for sharing these methods with us. I know, like you said, this is something that you are concentrating on. So you have a lot more context in recent years on this, right? So I hope the self-supervised method is out soon, and we get to see what you are already seeing.
Sure.
one of the things related to this is when I was in my previous company, we were actually trying to do model evaluation. I'm actually talking with respect to the second point you mentioned, where you are trying to look at samples which are more, not representative already in the labeled data set, right? So you want to find the more discriminative ones. So this is something we were doing in model evaluation as well, right? So when our model wasn't performing as well, we were trying to look at those cases where it was very deviating from the usual failure modes. So maybe when your predicted probabilities were even lesser than say 0.2 or 0.3, and then trying to figure out how is that data set even structured? Why is it so different from the other decisions that the model is being overlooked? So I think that technique of finding the most discriminant sample could be useful in a lot of different contexts that way.
Right.
And one of the things that could happen because of, say the teacher-student model could be that if your teacher is initially biased, your bias could creep into your entire system going forward, right? And then your entire labeled data set could have issues that you didn't imagine that it would have. So sometimes even there's unintentional bias that creeps into data sets if they're not carefully built. So have you seen such instances of bias in your data sets? And if yes, how have you tackled it? If not, what do you think we can do to ensure that we build more representative data sets? Of course, one tactic you mentioned is looking at discriminative samples, but is there anything else that you can tell?
Right. So that's a very important question, Imad. Bias is something that a lot of people who work in healthcare machine learning are really trying to address. In my own experience, I've seen bias creep in ways that are really, it's really befuddling to say the least. Among the projects that I can talk about, we've analyzed the data sets from this large scale healthcare survey that is in fact being conducted in the United States. Since the start of 1998 until now, in 2020, and it will continue in the future as well, where a lot of participants are being asked to share that there is a questionnaire on the healthcare indicators. For example, do you have diabetes or not? What's your height, weight? What's your race and ethnicity and so on. Among other questions in the data sets, there are for some of the participants, there are lab measurements available as well. And there are other questions, for example, if you've had, hepatitis A in the past, if you've been infected with hepatitis A in the past or not. And the list goes on. So there are questions on diet, there are questions on, lifestyle. How many times, do you eat vegetables and fruits in a week and so on. But we were very interested in analyzing these data sets for a number of reasons. Particularly, we were looking for indicators of future chronic disease incidence, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and so on. At some point during the analysis of this data, a manuscript appeared which talked about how it was possible for these authors who trained a machine learning model on chest X-ray to predict the race of the patient looking purely at the X-ray and nothing else, right? Mm-hmm. And that's a problem, right? I mean, it's an image and an X-ray at that, with no additional information, and the authors were able to predict the race of the patient by, it was a fairly well performing model, and they, to the author's credit, they tried a lot to impair the model from coming to its decisions by changing the resolution, decreasing the amount of details. If I recall correctly, they even went down as far as to reduce the resolution to 16x16.
I remember reading a Twitter.
The AROP was still like 65.65, right? And so that was very interesting. And so we thought, okay, can we detect the race if we remove the markers of, race and so on from the enhanced data set? And, oddly enough, the answer was yes. So looking nothing at but the health data coming from these large-scale survey participants, we were in fact able to identify, the race, and the AROC there was like 86% or above. I mean, we're still working on the study, so our preprint isn't out yet. But this goes on to tell you that there are many ways in which you may be leaking information to your model that you're not really aware of, right? And so what can you do about it? First, I think as model developers, we have to be aware of the many ways in which, these biases can creep in, right? And so once, whenever we analyze a problem, one of the first things we do is we do try to, explore the distribution of data along many dimensions, such as age, gender, ethnicity, race, and so on, to see if there's any, lack of representation in the data with respect to a particular dimension. And, there are ways in which you can compensate for it somewhat. I mean, I think a lot of us are very well familiar with class imbalance, dealing with class imbalance in these data sets. And so you can try to address it to some extent. Lastly, once a model is trained, instead of looking at, an aggregate overall metric such as accuracy, we actually try to look at, the performance metrics along these multiple dimensions through which bias can unintentionally creep in. Mm-hmm. And so this is an area we are continuing to focus on, learning as we go along to ensure that we're reducing the bias in the models that we train.
Yeah, I think one one news that had come out was I think Google image search was showing certain results that it shouldn't be showing because of the bias in their training data set. It's an ongoing process, I suppose, as you discover more and more dimensions along which you could have had bias, and then you try to fix those.
Particularly in healthcare, it's important because, on one hand, you have Turing Award winners like Geoffrey Hinton claiming that, radiologists should be worried for their jobs. Yeah. On the other hand, you have ground realities of that make healthcare an extremely hard problem to work on. And fair disclaimer, you know, I mean, I'm a big fan of Geoffrey Hinton, but it goes on to show you that, you know, healthcare is not as easy that, you know, a lot of people actually think. And so the least you can do is be humble about the models you train, you know, be aware of the potential shortcomings and be prepared to, you know, address the shortcomings.
Absolutely. And I think one question on that related note, right? So when you're trying to improve the performance of your model, what are some of the data pre-processing techniques that you've seen that have proven to work for you? Maybe you can share a few.
Sure. So, you know, I think Andrew Wang recently had a talk where he described from moving to model-centric to data-centric AI, right? And so I think a lot of people are now beginning to, not a lot of people, I think most people, I would say, have by now realized that this developing machine learning models is so much about the data itself. And so, among the few things we do is first we, you know, just manually and, you know, visually look at the data sets, right? Whether they be from imaging, from structured data sets or text or whatever it is, we, you know, sit down, actually look at the data set, try to understand what are the different dimensions in the data set. So getting familiar with the data set is extremely important because you sometimes, you know, come across things that are a short, I mean, let's say a problem with the data set that you wouldn't really find otherwise if you were not looking. I think Jeremy Howard, to his credit, in fast.ai course actually presents an example where, I think, was it the cars data set where he finds examples where the model does not perform well, mm-hmm. which were actually not even cars. I'm sorry, it was probably cats and dogs data set where Either way, so there are these, what he described was this data set actually claimed to have cats and dogs, but there were some images which were neither, right, where the model actually did not perform well. So, you know, so it's manual exploration is really important, so you can find these edge cases and take care of them. Among other things that we do is we look for ways to, train our model to make it more robust towards the many forms of variations that can occur in a data set. In medical imaging data set, you know, for example, applying augmentation techniques such as rotation, translation, shear, zoom in, zoom out, you know, changing the resolution a bit, among others. And among other things that we do is actually, you know, this is also a suggestion that Andre Carpathy talks about on his blog, is that actually look at the data as it, you know, goes through the different input stages right up until the point, you know, where it's mm-hmm. Taken into the model. Mm-hmm. And believe it or not, it has actually helped us many times, you know, in our real world applications where you start with, you know, reasonable assumptions. For example, okay, I'll introduce XYZ Gaussian blur, right? And then mm-hmm. you end up finding that, okay, the object that I'm trying to detect is probably lost by this extent of blur, mm-hmm. so I should probably tone it down a bit, right? Mm-hmm. So these are among the techniques that we've used. In general, you know, we look at regularizing the model training chain all throughout. So you have the data part, the model part, the metric part. And so we use several regularization techniques uh-huh. on the data, model, and metric to ensure that we have a model that is well regularized and that, you know, does not learn these shortcuts.
All right. Thanks for sharing those with us. And I think we have time for one last question and then we can open the forum for audience questions if there are any.
Sure.
So I think this is going to be a bit more generic sort of a question on, because there are a lot of people out there who are looking to get in the field and they've been like, spoiled for resources, so to speak. So they always have these questions around what resources to focus on and all of that. So I would maybe just put it as simple as one line. So what are the skill sets required to succeed and grow in, say, the data science, machine learning, AI industry? And I mean, if you have a few resources that you would like to share, you can go ahead.
Sure. I think one has to be comfortable with programming. So you should at least be, you know, comfortable writing codes in Python. You know, that's sort of become the language of choice for most ML practitioners. You should also be able to understand the code written by others. And this is where, if you have an intermediate to somewhat advanced level of exposure to Python, you can really thrive, because, you know, as you said, Ima, there are so many resources, there are so many code bases available on GitHub which you can, you know, take a look at and learn from. It does require you to understand, you know, good Python programming practices, knowing how to write a class, and you know, some of the Python decorators, what are decorators in Python, and so knowing intermediate to advanced level of Python is extremely helpful. There are many Python programming courses available on Coursera where one could start, but it is one of those things where, you know, you learn with practice. So I can't recall a resource off the top of my head because I learned Python many years ago. But you know, any new person in the field has to make sure, you know, they're spending time in writing code, and not only reading about it. You also have to understand basics of the math involved. I think having high school level of exposure to topics from calculus, linear algebra, and probability would be a good start. But there are a number of resources, right, that one could refresh their knowledge. I think the introduction to statistical learning book by Daniela Witten, Tipshirani, and others is a great resource. That book actually uses R to write their examples, but you know, you can find others. And by no means an introductory book, and no one should be disappointed if they find it difficult to read. But an absolute favorite is Murphy's book on machine learning. I was looking up because it's on my shelf right here, and so you know, it's very comprehensive. It talks about probabilistic approaches in machine learning and covers many varieties of topics that would be of interest to someone who's you know, familiar with the basics of machine learning.
Okay, so what is your one line statement for someone who wants to just enter the field?
Start by doing it. I think Jeremy Howard's approach should work well for a lot of people who are new to the area and are probably intimidated by the amount of work that needs to be done to, you know, to get to the point where you can start producing result. But, and definitely don't let people scare you into believing you that you can't really do it if you don't be a master in math first or a master in advanced Python first. I think you can learn a lot as you go along. You know, it's a marathon, not a sprint. So you just have to have the dedication and stay focused.
All right. Yeah, sounds good.
I know it's very cliched, but you know, it's what I really think.
No, it is what it is. I mean, at the end of the day, it's about putting in the hours, I suppose, and then and then keep being at it all the time, and then you will see the result. I mean, it's, again, like I said, it's cliched, but it is what it is. Okay, I think with that, I come to an end of to the list of the questions that I had, but we can also take a look at the Q&A section and see if there's a few questions. I can already see, so I've brought one question on stage. I think Dr. Valley, I don't know who Dr. Valley is, but Dr. Valley asks a question. Does your company incorporate use of federated learning in healthcare?
We are familiar with federated learning approaches. We haven't We haven't had a use for it just yet because a lot of the data sets that we work with come from our local collaborators where we're able to provide them with a secure UAE-based cloud computing facility to be able to work with their data sets. Nevertheless, we are familiar with federated learning approaches on how to implement it and how to execute it. So we'd be able to do it if there ever was a need.
Okay, I hope that is answered. And
on that point, anyone interested in federated learning should really check out a recent paper coming from NVIDIA and Boston Medical Group Cluster. It's on how they implemented federated learning to learn from more than 20 participating sites spread all across the globe. And the results are obviously very, very interesting to see that, with the combined data sets from these multiple sites, the performance of the model was actually better than what it would be if it was learned from, site-specific data. One of my dear friends, Anas Zainul Abedin, was a co-author on that paper, and he has a very good write-up on LinkedIn about the study, which I encourage everyone to check out.
Okay, let's get to the next question. Any ML use cases used for tabular data, example, patient level analysis or HCP level analysis? I think.
Assuming HCP is healthcare provider. Healthcare professional, okay. So yes, I mean there are many the analysis of healthcare survey data from NHANES that I talked about. That's we used a fair number of tabular data analysis approaches such as random forest, gradient boosting machines, and so on. In our projects on analysis of healthcare claims, healthcare finance data sets, healthcare operations data sets, we do explore address these problems as tabular data problems, and we look at both classical and modern machine learning algorithms to address them. It's really hard to beat gradient boosting machines if you tune it well is what I found, but there are approaches such as tab transformers and others which I've looked at applying deep learning to tabular data sets that I encourage everyone to check out.
I think one related question to that is when you use, say, gradient boosting machines or random forests, do you also try and look at their feature importances to figure out, and what do you do in general to figure out feature importances when you use, say, ensemble data?
We definitely do use feature importance methods. One thing to keep in mind is that these are all, a lot of the approaches that we have used in particular are all, retrospective post hoc analysis techniques, such as looking at the SHAP values. And it can give you a pretty good idea of what the model is using to make its decision among the variety of features, which ones are more important. But there are several limitations as well that one has to be aware of when and when not to trust what you see as an important feature. The short answer is yes, we do use SHAP, LIME, and other approaches to see what the model is thinking are important features.
No, thanks for bringing the limitations point, because I made a video on that just last week on YouTube. So go check that out if you want.
Absolutely,
to
I will.
No, I mean, not to you, but in general to everyone.
So, no. It's always good to learn new things.
So there was a paper on general pitfalls on using model agnostic machine learning, interpretable machine learning technique, which is again SHAP, LIME, and all of these techniques. Christoph Molnar, who has written the interpretable machine learning book, is like the lead author of this paper. So what I essentially did was try to summarize what he has done in the paper. So yeah, I have that video on YouTube. I mean, I'm just bringing it up because it came up.
No, absolutely. I'd love to check it out because I really like his book. We use it. We've read chapters from it. We recommend it to all of our team members, new interns, and so on. So I'd love to check out your video.
Ideally, I mean, maybe for you, you could directly read the paper. You don't need to check my summary of the paper, but okay, so that's all right.
Sure.
The next question is from Case One. How ML or DL techniques are leveraged in computational neuroscience? Any use cases in brain
Sure. In computational neuroscience, you could be using the ML or DL techniques to analyze, the connections between different parts of the brain. So as an example, it turns out you can use the, you can represent a brain's connectome as a graph, right? And so once you have converted essentially this, you know, diffusion tracts that describe what is the strength of connections, and I'm simplifying things here a bit. So in a neuroscientist, don't take offense. But once you've quantified what is the strength of these connections between different areas of the brain, you can formulate that as a graph. And once you have a graph essentially representing the connections of an individual brain, you can then go on and apply any number of graph machine learning or deep learning techniques to for a variety of reasons, right? So one approach again could be to try to identify which is, let's say, a model graph representing what ideally the connections within the brain should look like, and then what would with reference to this model graph, what would constitute an abnormality, right? And what would be the impact of it? Among other applications, you could be using it to study the spike train that is generated from the neurons, and that also relates to the brain-computer interfaces, right? So, if anyone who has seen Neuralink's demonstration of how they use these signals acquired from a pig's brain to for these creating these brain-machine interfaces. A lot of the interpretation there, I presume, is using some sort of machine learning or deep learning, though I don't think they've publicly disclosed what algorithms were used.
Okay, we have time for one last question. If there is any question, please drop them in the Q&A. We just have a minute, so if you drop it now, it will be taken up, or else maybe I think Shadab can take it later. You can also contact him perhaps on LinkedIn. Shadab,
sure.
That's okay. Okay, then I think there's no question that I can see. So thank you so much, Shadab, for this chat with us. It was really great having you it was really great having you today for this session. If you have any few last words that you would like to share, this is the time.
I'd just like to, say again that, when you enter the data science or machine learning field, a lot of things are very intimidating, right? And words like eigenvector and eigenanalysis, tormented me for a very long time, to be honest. It's important not to lose sight of the bigger picture. And often, as long as you are determined and you keep coming back to the concepts that you learn, and you're open-minded about the possibilities and limitations of the algorithm, I think you can go really far and long in data science as a professional.
Okay. All right then, thank you so much everyone for joining. I hope it was a good use of your time as well, and I will see you next month with yet another speaker or a webinar or fireside chat, whatever it is. I will see you next month. Until then, have a good time, and stay safe wherever you are. Thank you so much. Bye.
All right. Thank you, Imad. It was a pleasure talking to you.